Come on, everybody, get on your feet. Let's worship together. It's First Wednesday worship, and His grace is enough for us.
Great is your faithfulness, O God. You wrestle with the sinner's restless heart. Lead us by still waters into mercy, and nothing can keep us apart. So remember your people, remember your children, remember your promise, oh God. And all your people sing along. So remember your people, remember your children, remember your promise, oh God.
In these hands and multiply, God,
all that I am and bind my heart. On the altar again, set me on fire, set me on fire. Here I am, God.
Forever. moved for good, for the Lamb had conquered death. And the dead rose from their tombs, and the angels stood in awe, for the souls of all who come to the Father are restored. And the church of Christ was born, then the Spirit fit the flame. Now this gospel truth of old shall never kneel, shall not fade. By his blood and in his name, his freedom I am free. For the love of Jesus Christ, who has resurrected me.
Watching this, you're in your living room, just stand, lift your hands into the Lord in sweet surrender to Him today. Oh, we worship You, Lord. Atmosphere is changing now, for the Spirit of the Lord is here. The evidence is all around that the Spirit of the Lord is here. The atmosphere is changing. Spirit of the Lord is here. The evidence is all around that the Spirit of the Lord is here. Overflow in this place. Fill our hearts with Your love. Your love surrounds. Spirit of the Lord. God, fall fresh on us. We need your presence. Your kingdom come, your will be done here as in heaven. Spirit of God, fall fresh on us.
Thank you for your presence today. Move in our hearts today as we hear from you. In Jesus' precious name we ask. Amen.
Good evening, everybody. Welcome to First Wednesday. Tonight, I want to address the issue, why reopening the church matters. My answer is simple. It's because community matters. Romans 12:5 says, since we are all one body in Christ, we belong to each other, and each of us needs all the others. We need community with God. We need community with each other. God says, community, it's not optional. I miss you, my friends. I never realized how much being around y'all made me like just want to be with you, and I didn't notice it till you were gone. I didn't realize how much I loved being with you, and see, that's community. That's being a part of each other's lives. So why do we need our church family? Number one, we need others to walk with us. What does that mean? It means that I need you to help me grow spiritually. Do you know that the Bible often compares your journey, your life as a walk? Because really, we're on a journey. You don't just sit still in life, and you're not to where you're going to go just yet, and you're not stuck where you used to be. You're in this journey. So the Bible calls this your spiritual walk, or your Christian walk, or your Christian life. Throughout the New Testament, we're told to walk in wisdom. We're told to walk in love. We're told to walk in light. We're told to walk in obedience, to walk in the Spirit, to walk as Jesus walked. But one of the key ways that God tells us to walk is by never walking alone through life. Aren't you so sick of being alone? I know I am. You see, look at what happens in Genesis 2:18 at the very beginning, the very first thing that God did after he created Adam. He said this, "It's not good for man to be alone." He looked down at his perfect environment, all of his perfect creation in the Garden of Eden. He says, "Yo, that's not good for a man to be by himself." Why? Because God hates loneliness. He hates it. And he loves the word yo. So what is his antidote? He created two groups, a physical family and a spiritual family. Now, your physical family is the one that you grew up in, but your spiritual family is the one that you choose and you have for the rest of your life. That's Genesis church, baby. So God says, "I want you to be connected in my family as the church." Hebrews 10:5 says this, "Let us not give up in the habit of meeting together." Notice it's a habit. It's something that we do all the time. "Instead, let us encourage one another." Paul says, listen, you're created for community, and I want you to encourage each other by meeting together, being together. So what do we need our church family to do? Why do we need to be a part of our church family? Well, we also need our church family to work with us. We need others to work with us. God put you on this earth to do a specific work that only you can do. Ephesians 2:10, God made us to do good works, which he planned in advance for us to live our lives doing. Before you even born, God decided the talents that he was gonna give you. God decided the natural abilities that he was gonna place on your life. He decided your background, where you would be born, who your parents were gonna be, and that you would even be alive during this time. God knew that you would be alive during this crazy corona outbreak. Why? Because he has a plan and a purpose for your life. And part of that purpose is that he has a specific work for you to do. Anytime that you use your talents and your abilities to help somebody else, there's a word for that. It's called ministry. It's called servant leadership. When you use your gifts to help other people, you're doing exactly what God has called you to do. He calls that good works. God tells us in the Bible that we're supposed to do good works together, though. So Ephesians 4 says two people are better than one because they get more done by working together. They get more done by working together. Everybody knows this, right? So as you work as a team versus working as an individual, you begin to make a bigger impact. Look at prom, right? So God has called Genesis Church to serve. It's in the fabric of our church. It's in everything that, like, in my DNA makeup that has been, like, impudiated into you. Like, we've gelled into this church that we are a model for other churches on how to serve the community in which we live. We got to get back to doing that. We got to get back to being ourselves. We got to get back to our calling as a local church, modeling servant leadership, modeling ministry. Do you know how bad our friends with special needs miss us, miss our presence in their lives? They've missed the spring fling. They've missed their summer luau. We were supposed to host the Gretchen Everhart graduation here, and like that got nixed. But really what they're really disappointed in is they just don't get to see you. They don't get to be with you. I hear from them all the time. Or literally, Wade FaceTimes me every single day. So we've got to get back to being a part of their lives. Think about the other groups that need us. How many people are hurting because of Corona? What can we do as a church to bless the west side of Tally? Can we start a drive-through food bank? Can we help the elderly by figuring out how to pinpoint where they live and mow their lawns or bring them meals? Can we please set up some tutoring help for the last 3 weeks of hell, I mean school? Praise God for those who can do high-level math. Hallelujah, glory, right? We need help, and we need to help because we are called to serve. And we've got to get back to doing what we do. We got to get back to serving together. Finally, church, we need to pray. We need others to pray with us. I need you to pray with me. There is nothing like being in the presence of God. There's nothing like it. I just feel the power of the Holy Spirit hit me all over the place right now. Where two and three are gathered in his name, man, and we call out to his name, we see mountains begin to move. Our attitudes get adjusted to his will, not our own. Our burdens get lifted. Our spirits get replenished and refilled. I need that. You need that. We need to be in the house of God together. I'm a standing and worshiping and praying in the presence of God with you. Listen, I love stay-at-home online church. That is an option. If we didn't have that option, man, this would have been really, really hard to get through. But there's nothing like being in church, worshiping with you in the presence of God. There's nothing like it. And for those of you who've never attended or just watch online, you don't know what I'm talking about. But I need you to be here. You need to be more than a spectator. You need to experience God. So how do we fix all this? We open the doors. We are going to do a limited reopening in 10 days on May 17th. Now, don't tune me out. I know that's the big wow factor here tonight and the big thing that you're waiting for. When are we going to reopen? But let me explain how that's going to work. I'll do it in a second. But first, here's what we have. We have 10 days. We have 10 days starting tomorrow from now until the day we reopen. So I'm going to give you one more major Genesis Church quarantine time challenge to do with me. It's called Park and Pray. Park and Pray. I want you to come to our church parking lot over the next 10 days at any time during the day, evening, and pray in your cars. If you want to get out of your cars, wear a mask, social distance yourself, blah, 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 get a lawn chair and pray, walk around the church and pray. I don't care. But I want you to come here and park and pray. It can be 5 minutes. It can be 5 hours. It doesn't matter. What does matter is the obedience and the effort. That matters. I can't wait to see the parking lots flooded with community. You can roll down your windows, put on a mask, pray with each other out loud. I can't wait to feel the presence of God when I pull up in this place over the next 10 days. You see, my mama reminded me this week that it was 10 days from when Jesus ascended into heaven until the pouring out of the Holy Spirit in Acts chapter 2. We have 10 days until our reopening starting tomorrow. Do you see the supernatural significance of this? It's crazy. We cannot have lined this up if we tried. My question is, do you want to see supernatural results and God's Spirit poured out in 10 days? If so, let's make our cars the upper room and believe that when we open these doors again, the windows of heaven are going to open up and revival in our church is going to rush in. The timing of this thing is insane. We could not have planned it this way. Do you know that on day one of the 10 days, that first day, tomorrow, Thursday, is the National Day of Prayer? Day one of our 10-day challenge starts with the National Day of Prayer. God is setting us up. So are you going to participate in this process and receive the blessing? If so, park and pray. Park and pray. Tomorrow until Saturday, May 16th, start praying. If you can't get here physically, pray. Pray now. Go out in your car and pray. I don't care. But start praying for the next 10 days until the days return to us where we get to open up our church and we will see something amazing happen. That God's Spirit is going to be poured out in a way that we've never seen on anyone and everyone who steps through these doors. Now, let's switch gears, okay? What is the reopening going to look like? What am I going to be required to do in order to show up and participate at Genesis Church 929 or 1101 experience? All right, this Sunday is the last online-only service at Genesis. So Mother's Day is the last Sunday that we're going to be meeting online only. Last one. Online is still going to continue like it always does, but we are reopening the doors again May 17th. That's 10 more days to watch and see what happens with Corona in our community. We're being wise. We are trying to use all the information that is provided to us so that we can protect you. So reopening day is a week after Mother's Day. The 17th, we're going to open at a third capacity with two services at 9:29 and 11:01. Same service as always. In every service, we will be using reservations in order to attend. You will need to fill out a reservation form in order to attend. You simply go on your phone to gctv.link or on your computer to genesischurch.tv, click the button, fill out the reservations form. It's like your name and the number of your party that it will be attending. And here's what happens. We will arrange the auditorium in a way where you will sit together with your party. And when your party ends, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, we will take out two seats and put the next group of people so that we will protect you. We are going to also remove every other row so that you will be protected. This whole thing, guys, is first come, first serve. So go to gctv.link, genesischurch.tv, and you will fill out the form. Now, reservations for the 17th will cut off the Friday night at midnight prior. So on the 15th, when it hits 11:59, it's done. And we'll do the same thing for every week following until we get back to normal. So Friday night at midnight before that coming Sunday is the cutoff date. And then that gives us Saturday in order to rearrange the chairs, and I will rearrange the seating chart for you, and then I will make a loop and blast it out to everybody. So if you've never filled out a Connect card, right now, go to gctv.link on your phone and fill out a Connect card. Adam, make sure you got a Connect card ready for tonight because we are going to get blasted. I want you to get in the loop so that every single time I send something out, you receive it. So every Saturday morning, you're going to get a new seating chart and updated information, walk-ins. What about walk-ins who have no idea about our policy? We're going to have some seats socially distanced spread out in the back for individuals, and that's what's going to happen. They'll fill in the back seats, and then we will have overflow in our elementary room, and then in the studio if need be. And so those TVs will have streaming services live, just like we're doing in church, but it just gets people to get together. So if they show up, they're still worshiping together. It's still powerful, but those seats will be spaced out individually. We may add an 8:08 a.m. or most likely a 5:05 p.m. depending on this response. Here's something else we're doing. We're going to go back to the black chairs. They may not be the most comfortable things in the world, but we can spray them down and we can wipe them down with this stuff in between each one. You can still find this. Windex kills 99.9% of germs. It's still on the shelves. I have no idea how, but Lysol wipes, you can't find them. Here's what I want you to do. Go out. They will let you buy one at Walmart each. Go buy one now and bring it and donate it to church. And what we're going to do is we are going to spray down every seat and wipe it down before each service. There will be a donation bin outside, and you can just drop it in on the way into church. Again, it's the yellow Windex. Multi-service, and it kills 99.9% of germs. It kills the coronavirus just like Lysol does. Now, here's what I'm asking. I'm asking the at-risk population to continue to watching services online until you feel comfortable joining us. Masks. Masks are encouraged. I don't care if you feel like you look like a dork. Put them on. All right? I will not be preaching in this, but listen, I'm going to be shaking your hands. I'm going to be talking to you through a mask. It's literally fogging up my glasses. I don't care. But I'm doing this before I get up to speak. Now, I won't do it so you could read my lips when I'm up here, but wear a mask. Wear a mask. They are for your protection. During meet and greet, we're going to nix it. We'll probably turn around and say, hey, to people around you, but there's no hugging, there's no handshaking, there's no high fives. I know you're really going to want to, like, hug people, but listen, just social distance yourselves for a bit. Another announcement, there's going to be no cafe. It's BYOC. Bring your own coffee, right? There's no drinking fountain, so bring your own water bottles. Right next to that are the restrooms. So let's talk the potties. Listen, they're going to be available for emergencies only. Please go to the restroom before you arrive here. Don't drink 6 bottles of Diet Mountain Dew like I do before church every service, right? Just know that those are for emergencies only. Now, we're going to have attendants. Again, I'm going to need some people to volunteer, but I'm going to have restroom attendants in the restrooms, by the restrooms, to clean up after each use. We're going to wipe down sinks, toilet seats, door handles, and the flush handles. We are installing this week foot door openers to open the restroom doors without having to touch anything. If you're willing to be attendant, again, I need a couple volunteers. There will be hospitality kits on the sinks. You'll be provided with gloves, wear your own masks. Just write in that chat box right now, restroom 929, restroom 1101. Pick a time and just say, yeah, I'll do that. Restroom 1101, restroom 929. And I'll get you on the service list. Again, I will blast that out with a loop with your seating chart every Saturday morning. And then all you have to do is show up 15 minutes beforehand, get at your post where we assign you to, and and then come and attend the other service and worship with us. So to avoid door contact, again, foot door openers for the bathrooms, but we're also just going to keep the sanctuary doors open. No one needs to roam the lobby. There's going to be partitions. There's going to be one entry and one exit. So when you're looking at the church, the right one will be where you come in at. The left one is where you exit. We'll have greeters at the doors to open the door, so don't touch the door handles. Someone's going to open it for you. Also, you're going to get emailed maps of the seating charts, but I'm going to post those same emailed maps on the glass outside the church doors so you can look and figure out where you sit. You can pull it up on your phone by pulling up the email and just looking at the seating chart, but I will also post them on the back walls of the auditorium in between the distance seats so that you can see where you go and you sit. You find your own seat. No usher will be able to help you. We will make sure that there are enough lights open and up in here so that you can see where you're going. It's going to look a little bit different and feel a little bit different, but listen, we're doing everything that we can possibly think of to keep you safe. So there's another reason why we're not doing this. We will have no kids' church or nursery or special needs possibly until phase 2, because little kids love to hang on each other and rub everything and touch everything. And it's just impossible to keep them separated. So until we get to about maybe 50%, parents, you're going to have to hang on to your kiddos, all right? Teach them at this time church etiquette. Church etiquette. Maybe you don't know church etiquette, so let me give you a little bit of heads up on here's what we do. All right, we don't move around during the message. We don't get up and walk around. We don't talk out loud during the message. We go potty before coming to church because ours are emergency use only. But regular times, we stand and we worship. We sing out loud. Teach your kids right now to lift holy hands. Bring some change with you so that they can participate and put it in the offering bucket so they can learn generosity as a child. Show them how to respect God's house. Bring something, clean up. If you've got spills, clean them up, man. We just had everything shampooed. Show them how to respect God's house. Show them that coming to church is fun, right? And that it matters to be a part of a church. Have some kind of busy packet. I don't care if it's an iPad with headphones or a coloring book. It's all good. Listen, I am not going to be offended by that. They are kids, and at some point, they will tune me out. Some point, you tune me out. So imagine your children. Listen, I know babies are going to cry. Bring that passy. If they get super noisy, we're going to have the nursery opened up and deep cleaned so that it's a cry room, and it'll be streaming in there as well. That's okay. go for a few minutes, and you can come back in. It's all good. I'll keep preaching. Again, I'm not going to be offended. But listen, what we want to do is keep movement to the least amount as possible so that everyone can keep focus on the Word of God. It's just church etiquette. It's what we should be doing every single Sunday, even when we're not socially distancing. It's so that everyone can continue to pay attention. And at this time, man, use it as a teaching tool. You've been teaching this whole time anyways. Put it to use in the church. Now, a few more things that we're going to do. No more worship guides for the time being on Connect Cards. Continue to use gctv.link for your phone. It's meant for your phone. It's built for your phone. It's got your Connect Card on there. It's got links to giving, all that. Physical giving offering. We're going to put offering buckets up here. You're going to social your distance yourself as a line in the aisles and come up and drop offering bucket stuff and then go back to your seats. It'll just be a circle. So we're going to do that for a while. We're going to go old school, drop it in the dropping of the offering and praise the Lord while doing that. It's going to be all right. We're not going to do iPads or kiosks. So keep using gctv.link on your phone and give there. Listen, please don't forget to give. We had another rough week last week. We can't keep doing that. I know that you might not have a job. There's no one expecting you to give. But for those that have jobs and are just like, you know, not scheduling it or thinking, oh man, I forgot to be in church because I watched online. Listen, we need your participation. Get on board. This economy, this virus can't take us under. I don't really believe it's going to, but if you don't support us like I'm doing and like you're doing, and it's something we do out of love for God and it's habitual, man, this church will sink. So we need everybody. So please take the time to make sure that you have your apps ready to give or bring it physically and drop it in the bucket. Use checks, use cash, go old school, who cares? All right, a few more things to help you relax when you walk in here. There will be two pub tables in the back. They will have pumps of hand sanitizer on it. We just bought 2 gallons of hand sanitizer to keep refilling those bad boys so that you can feel free if you touch something and you're like, oh, I forgot to wash my hands. Use that, okay? Also, this week, the sanctuary I mentioned has been professionally shampooed, and as well as all the hallways. And Miss Maurice and the staff are deep cleaning the lobby, auditorium, and cry rooms before opening day. We have, listen, try to think of everything. I deep cleaned the volunteer room. I mean, I will put up signage galore because that's what I do. I'll put it all around the church so you don't forget to do certain things. Listen, if we see that reservations are filling up, we'll add the other service. So invite. Don't be afraid to show up. Don't be afraid to invite. We'll make sure that everybody's socially distanced and that we have the right amount of people in our auditorium, in our church at one time. But I want you to come and I want you to sit together as a group. I won't be afraid to preach 3 and 4 times on a Sunday. Adam will sing till his throat falls off. Listen, it's what we do. We love you and we want you to be a part of church, be a part of us here. Now, the reservation form will be available this Sunday after the 1101 experience ends on Mother's Day. Reminder, you've got 10 days to be praying for safety, for healing, for revival, for salvation, for dreams to be rekindled. You've got this time to pray for our economy to rebound, for people to get jobs. You've got this time to pray wisdom and guidance over our president who takes so much heat for everything he does. I don't care if you're a Democrat or Republican. In moments like this, you support by prayer, by asking God to give our leaders in Congress and in the Senate wisdom and cooperation so that we can heal. It's time to pray. It's so time to pray. I will see some of you in the parking lot tomorrow at Park and Pray. I love you, and I cannot wait to be back with you in just 10 days. Let's pray. Lord, I thank you for this time. I thank you, Lord, for the hope, Lord, that is welling up in each and every one of us, Lord, as we see the light at the end of this tunnel. Lord, we've been through kind of a dark time, a rough time, Lord, for so many. They've lost loved ones during this. God, I pray, Lord, that you just fill them, Lord, with your peace that passes human understanding. God, that you would just give them joy in the middle of sorrow. Turn mourning into dancing, I ask. beauty for ashes. Lord, I pray a hedge of protection around our church. God, as we reopen, give us wisdom on what to do, when to pull back and when to push forward. Help us continue, Lord, to be the leaders that you called us to be in this community, to lead by example, to lead by love, to get back to serving. And Lord, I pray as we get together and we park and pray that your spirit, Lord, will invade our lives and pour out in such a mighty way on May 17th. God, that our minds are blown. I pray for souls to be saved. I pray for people who are just drowning in addiction right now to be set free. For those that are suffering from depression, from isolation, Lord, I pray you just completely renew their spirit. Lord, change the atmosphere, Lord, as we walk into this place on the 17th. And let it be because we were obedient to the call on our lives to park and pray. We love you, Lord. Protect us, I ask. Keep pushing us forward for your glory, for your faith, to know you and to make you known. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. I love you. Go to gctv.link, fill out a connect card so that we can get your information. And then again, I will see you this Sunday online only for Mother's Day. I got something special for you. My mom is going to come and share a little bit of a story from her life. It's going to be an amazing Sunday. Do not miss. Tune in 9:29, 11:01. This week, no cry stand, make them known. See you Sunday.